Our first guest today is the creator of some truly iconic work. He's been described as the godfather of British pop art and has been a major influence on many of today's young British artists. Sir Peter Blake has produced paintings and collages that have become embedded in modern culture. Now he's exhibiting his portraits for the first time at a new show in London that includes paintings that have never been seen before. And Sir Peter is with me here now. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Hello.
7 decades working, the first time your portraits have been exhibited. Why now?
I just felt it was time. You know, as I get older, I realised how many portraits I'd done. And they've always... I'm not a professional portrait painter, so they've always been done privately for people. And I just suddenly thought it'd be nice to show them. So I hinted around a little bit to some of the galleries, and no one picked up on my hints. So I thought, well, I'm due for a show with my gallery, the Waddington Cousteau Gallery. Why don't I show them there rather than in a museum? So we borrowed them all back.
You say you're not a portrait painter. How do you rate your own work, then?
Well, I'm not a professional portrait painter. That's not what the way I make my living. I do a good likeness, is the way I rate it.
Very modest.
Yeah.
An incredible range of portraits that you've painted. We've got the Queen among the collection,
yeah.
Eric Clapton. I particularly like the story of the Everly brothers, because they commissioned you to paint this one, didn't they? Tell me about that.
Yes, that was a commission for a record cover. I think it was called On the Wings of a Nightingale, when they recorded in London. And it was a straightforward commission. I photographed them both. I photographed Don looking straight at him and Phil looking in from the side. And at the time, Don had put on rather a lot of weight. And although I was very flattering with the... Because I work from photographs. So I reduced his size a bit in the photograph. But even then, I think he felt it didn't flatter him, so they simply didn't use it.
How funny. You say you work from photographs, and yet there's a portrait there of Helen Mirren that was painted from life. The last time you did that, why did you decide not to do that again?
It's quite difficult to explain. Helen arrived... We met, it was a long time ago, when she was playing Cleopatra in London. She arrived on our doorstep, looking glorious, as she always does. And, I simply wanted to paint a little portrait. We'd met and talked about doing it. And I think she was very happy. She would have been very happy to have undressed on the spot, I felt, you know. So I got nervous. And I just stayed nervous. I never enjoyed that rapport, that intimacy between the painter and the sitter. Some people, that's what it's all about, you know. But in my case, as I say, I'm a jobbing portrait painter who gets a good likeness.
Now, there are 3 portraits, I believe, in the collection of Ian Dury, who was a friend of yours, wasn't he? Were they all done from photographs as well?
Yes, they were all jobs. It ended up just being 2. The other one I didn't get around to borrowing back. But I think one was for a book recently, and the other one was for a record. So a lot of that work was... There's a section which is pure portraiture, and there's a section which is jobs, as it were, you know, commercial jobs.
And Ian Dury, he was a pupil of yours,
didn't he? He was, yeah.
That. Was he a good pupil?
I taught him in 1961 at Walthamstow School of Art, and then he got into the Royal College of Art, and I happened to get the job there. So I taught him pretty much right through his career, and we became friends, and I followed the progress of Kilburn and the High Roads and the blockheads. I'm an honorary blockhead. I've got a gold blockhead badge.
Right.
Yep.
And you've got an honorary doctorate of music from Liverpool University,
because
of your work is music-based.
Yeah.
What's the fascination with Elvis? Because he's almost the centrepiece of this portrait exhibition.
Yeah, I'd planned a whole exhibition of shrines to Elvis, based on the fact that the centrepiece would have been a shed, a real shed, that somebody made a shrine in, you know, a fictitious person. And then suddenly there were a lot of sheds in art. You couldn't need a Parker blew one up, and there were various sheds, and it didn't seem appropriate. So the shed sits in my studio empty, but I started a big shrine in 3 sections, and I suddenly decided to show that and another earlier shrine. So I recreated that exhibition on a smaller scale. I think it's a matter as I get older, of ticking boxes. You know, so now I've done that exhibition. It's nice to have done it.
And you've always been a huge fan of his, have you?
Well, that's a difficult question because he's not my favourite. But if you're going to paint an icon of rock and roll, you choose Elvis.
Yeah.
And if you're going to paint a beautiful blonde woman, you choose Marilyn. So it's in a way, he's the main icon, and I do like him, but he's not my favourite.
Let's talk about the Tracy Emin painting.
Yeah.
It's called Playing Chess with Tracy.
Yeah.
She's very recognisable, perhaps, to people. Perhaps less so is the man in the painting, Marcel Duchamp, although, for those in the art world, very influential. He was the man who first put a urinal in a museum.
Absolutely.
And called it art.
Yeah.
How influential has he been for you? Because you've included him in a lot of your works.
Well, I think the big thing was that he made a statement, which I can never quite quote absolutely correctly, but it was to do with the fact that if you make a piece of art, therefore it's art. So if somebody says that's not art, I mean, if you're an artist and you make it, it is art. And that's what Duchamp said, and that's what it opened the door to a lot of artists to make art they might not have made. So that series is called Marcel Duchamp's World Tour, and it's my thank you to him. And so he travels the world in a rock and roll tour bus, and I give him nice things. Nice things happen to him. So one is playing chess with Tracy. Another one is, at the time, was the Spice Girls meeting Elvis and Marcel Duchamp meeting them. Well, and that never could have happened.
It's like a fantasy dinner party.
It's a magical mystery tour. It's a fantasy tour.
I'm interested because you've got these two figures together, Tracy Emin and Marcel Duchamp. How much of an influence do you think you've been to Tracy Emin and the other young British artists in the same way that Marcel Duchamp's influenced you?
In a way, it's not for me to say, is it? I think that there's certainly the pop art movement certainly influenced the YBA. In a way, it's not for me to claim where I influenced people.
But she's a friend of yours, isn't she?
She's a friend, yeah.
Have you ever spoken to you about it personally?
Not really, no.
Okay.
No, I did meet all the YBAs very early on, and most of them are friends. Mm-hmm. And I admire what they do. I'm a great fan of Damien Hirst and defend him often because people ask me and expect me not to like what he does. And I think he's a very good artist. So I am a friend of the YBAs.
Let's talk about the pop art movement and your place within it, because people often think of Andy Warhol as the father of pop art, and yet I've read that you say that it's thanks to you that that phrase was coined in the first place.
I claim that. I mean, a really quick history of pop art is that it started in three places in the mid-50s, in America with Jasper Johns and Robert Rauschenberg, in London at the Independent Group at the ICA, who were a group of intellectuals who discussed popular culture, and me as a young student at the Royal College, painting the world I knew. You know, as a working class boy in the art world, I knew about wrestling and football and stuff like that, and fairgrounds. So that was the beginning of pop art, and then a couple of years later was another movement that was Warhol and Lichtenstein and the famous pop artists. What I claim is that there used to be a critic called Lawrence Alloway, who was a great supporter of the pop artists, of young artists. He gave a dinner party and we were talking about art, and I was trying to explain what I was trying to do, which at that moment I was trying to make a picture that if someone was a fan of Elvis and liked the music, they could look at the picture and like the picture. So it was equivalent. And Lawrence said, what a kind of pop art.
Right.
And I claim that's how it was invented.
OK. So then when Warhol and those others started using it, had they heard of it from you, or how did that work?
No, and then it developed as a movement. We were generally kind of vaguely thrown together as a general movement. There were rivalries between American pop art and British pop art. It wasn't in America's interest that there was an art movement somewhere else which was equivalent.
Yes. You knew Warhol, you met him.
Yeah.
Was there a friendship there? How was that relationship?
I don't think anyone was friends with Andy. I mean, we met about eight times. I would say we were friends, but we never had a conversation.
Right.
I mean, he was very loath to speak, and I was very reticent at that point anyway. So we'd meet and we'd greet. I went to the factory and he showed me around, and I met a few of the people at the factory. So we knew each other, but I wouldn't say we were friends.
But were you making the images of Elvis before he was?
What I did first, as that's the question, I made a box. You know, I made a three-dimensional wooden box, which was a Captain Webb matchbox, before he made the suit boxes. And I did a drawing at the Royal College, which was a straightforward copy of a comic book. It was called... it was the Justice League of America, and it was called The Flight of Failures, and it simply copied a comic book, and that was before Lichtenstein did his comics. So there were a few things that I used first.
I want to ask you about Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club
Band.
You design. I have to. You're so known.
You can't not.
I mean, your album cover is as iconic as the music itself on that album. How do you feel that that is still a thing that people ask you about all these years on?
I suppose it's as you say, you know, that the what's happened over the years. And we were just saying in 2 years' time, it's 50 years ago that we did it in 67, which is alarming and surprising. But I think what's happened over the years is as the LP became a kind of art form, the covers became an integral part of the LP. So people like Storm Thorgerson and you doing and Hypnosis, it became as important, I think. My problem is that it's never been recognised that it is important.
Oh, right, you feel
I
that?
I think
do you?
I do. Yeah,
that's interesting. Yeah. Okay, one of the other themes that you revisit is that of tattoos.
Yep.
What's the fascination with that? They feature in the portraits exhibition.
Well, again, at this point, it's very common to see a tattooed person. The first one I did would have been in about 1956, and it was quite rare then. A tattooed person would have probably been an exhibit in a fun fair, you know, as a completely tattooed person. But it's one of my interests in popular culture, you know, along with wrestling and boxing and all the other things I'm involved with.
Yes, because there's also quite a lot of wrestling images.
Yeah, in the show, it breaks into three parts. You know, the actual portraits, a room of the Elvis, which we've talked about, and in the other room, there are 10 watercolours of tattooed people, 10 watercolours of wrestlers and 10 paintings of wrestlers.
We can see some of those now. There's a cowboy there.
Yeah, that cowboy is not very well disguised, Brad Pitt.
Ah.
This one is called Considerate Boy, and that's the phrase that Max Miller, the comedian, used to describe gay men, which is the most beautiful phrase.
Yes.
So a gay man is a considerate boy.
Hence the mask, I guess?
Well, that's Robert De Niro.
Right.
Again, rather badly disguised. That's Princess Perfect. So they're fictitious. They become fictitious.
Which of these is your favourite? Do you have one?
Of that group?
Yes. Of the exhibition?
Oh, in the whole exhibition, it's one of the portraits. It's a double portrait of Stuart Grimshaw and Simon Sainsbury, painted in their garden, and there's another portrait of Charles Cholmondeley, and I'm surprised at the skill I used. You know, that the shirt is beautifully painted, and Charles is wearing a tweed jacket where it's completely painted. I can't believe I did it.
That's so incredible. After all your success, you're still surprised that you've...
Still surprised. Well, I haven't seen them for a long time, and a lot's happened, so it is a surprise to see them again.
Does it get easier, the work?
Technically it does, because you've learnt the trade. You know, when you start, you don't know how to mix orange, but you learn that if you put red with yellow, it makes orange. And then the next time, you're more skillful. Well, I'm very skillful now, so the technicalities of it are easier. But you've still got to think why you paint and what you're going to paint. But I still enjoy it so much. I like, if there is a difficulty, I like it.
That's
if there's
sweet.
A problem.
Okay, that's the key. Lovely to hear that you still enjoy it.
So yeah, very much.
It's been lovely having you on the programme.
Nice to talk to you.
And Peter Blake, Portraits and People, is at Waddington Cousteau Galleries, London, until the 30th of January 2016.